Good afternoon. My name is Justin Glenn. I'm from DVN, and you'll be pleased to know that the suit and tie is not giving the next presentation. I'm here to introduce Sumichi Ihara, who's flown from Japan down specifically to give this paper today. Sumichi works for DVN, and he leads the team of Lustre developers. He's not just a manager, he's a leader, and he's come from a very strong Lustre background. He's considered to be one of the best Lustre developers in the globe. And certainly, I've heard the Intel folks say that outside of Intel, of course, he does lead the best development team in America, so that's very nice. And I hope that it's true. part of Sumichi's job is to look at how we can value add to the Intel Enterprise Edition Lustre stack. And that's what we do for our customers, and this is part of what we do. So thanks very much, Sumichi.
Thanks, Justin. So this is a very technical session, so there's no marketing or sales session. So I want to talk about the Lustre replication of the migration tool. So there's a background, so what we are working on the replication of the migration tool. So everybody knows that so data backup is so critical. So many the backup, the replication requirements are coming. So sometimes, so Lustre needs to be the migrate from the older system to the new system, because the older system is retired. Now is a good timing to think about petabytes, petascale, the Lustre file system backup. So Daniel this morning mentioned and talked about his experience, the real experience is petaclass Lustre data migration. So that is really encouraging for us. Malcolm also mentioned the future Lustre. So it's probably the Lustre replication future is possible, but that's not ready yet. So Lustre tiering, so this is also the possible. It's not HSM, but several storage devices existing today, or SSD, but NVMe in the past year, then throw this from the behind. Or some of the use case, the people want to write the data to SSD, then eventually migrate the data through this. However, so Lustre it's supported, but it's a lack of the user space utility today. So there's several terminology for the data replication or the migration. So I want to talk about data replication here, about it's a more fine level the backup, fine level the replication. That means two independent, the different namespace, but sometimes they say the file system. Then we replicated the primary file system to the backup file system asynchronous. So if we have the Lustre file system, the both the primary and the backup file system, so we can mount the Lustre client to both file system, then copy it from the primary to the backup file system. So data migration, so that means this is the data migrating from the one of the specific OSD device to the another OSD device. But we want to keep the same Lustre metadata or namespace. That means so the application can access the data even after the migration, so transparently, even after the data migrates from the one OSD to another OSD. So this is a very similar idea of the HSM, but HSM is more file style called from the JPEG library. So that is a more disk-based and transparent data access in the OSD. So we are working on developing two utilities, so we call the LD-Sync and the LD-Migrate for this data replication, the migration area. So we want to introduce. So I want to introduce two today.
So there's two major challenge on the data backup on the replication on the large scale file system. Daniel also mentioned that if we look at the data scale file system, so that is a really challenging. So one of the challenge is a file system data detection. So initial on data copy is fine, so backup file system is empty, so you can copy all the file to the backup file system. But once we synchronize data between the primary file system and the backup system, so next backup, so we have to detect so which file have to migrate from synchronize from the primary file system to the backup file system. So this is really the annoying a lot of time consuming. So there are several ways to determine the which file have to migrate. So there are several metadata attributes. So we can check the end time or size or check something like that. Then we can detect which file to migrate. So this is always depends on how much file the store into the primary file system. So number of the items is stored in the file system. So another challenge is the data copy speed. So not only the many small file, but if you look at the large single file, so this is also a big challenge because if you think about the copy of one file, the large file, this is no parallelization. So you need to think about the large single file, a single shared file with data copy speed. The other thing, even though we have so many data copy nodes, let's say the data mover node, but we probably need some more dynamic, the data backup job, the allocation. Otherwise, some of the data mover node is idle, but some of the data mover nodes is so busy. So we probably need to manage more elegant manage dynamic process allocation for data copy. So this is some overlap on the Daniel slide on this morning. So I want to introduce the major copy tool, the rsync and BCP. So as you know, the rsync already. So this is to maintain more than 10 years. So it's the packaged many of the Linux distribution already. It supports many future. It's not bad, but it's lack of the parallelization option. So we have now the look at the file utility. So this is more designed for the scalability and the performance. The project basically started 3 or 4 years ago. So among the several US laboratory collaboration effort. Then so DDN, so we are also involved in this project at the beginning of the project. So we have been working more than 3 years for this project. Then finally, so this this software is open source last year, so we are so happy to contribute this source code. So DCP, so this is a part of the file utility. So this is a copy tool. So parallel copy by the API. So not only the raster, so you can copy it from the raster to the other file system, NFS or GPFS, but there's any the project file system is supported. And so this is great. Even the single shared file, so they can split the chunk, then allocate the MPI process, then send to the backup file system. So it's more elegant, efficient the data copy, even the single shared file. So the next challenge, so more detail about the file system delta detection. So if we think about the rsync, so initial copy is fine. So the backup file system always empty. So but after the rsync again, after the synchronization, so sometimes it takes a few hours or more the delta detection if you have so many inodes between the file system. So DCP, it's also they can do the parallel, you know, file system the delta detection with MPI. That is much faster than rsync. However, still a lot of the time consuming and a lot of the metadata, the pressure the primary file system. So that is not good. So we have the raster. So the raster has a change log. So change log is a rescue. Raster change log, so recording the event, all the raster file system, so that what's happened between the time to time. So we can keep the timestamp, so we can keep the file identifier, the file ID, and we can keep the what's metadata operation from the client. So we can keep the these change log in the raster MDT. So if we can use this raster change log for the file system detection, so we don't need the file system scanning anymore, except the initial copy. So the base on the diesel technology, so we are developing the synchronization tool, FD-Sync. So this is a similar idea on the raster rsync. So if you have a raster, if you look at the raster source code, so you can see that the raster rsync script. But this is just a simple script. The single thread, but still the rsync is running behind. It's supported the change log. It's about it's very the partial the change log support. So the goal of the FD sync, so this is a replacement of the raster rsync. So this is the parallel synchronization framework, not only just two, but just a framework including raster change log analyzer. So change log analyzer, so once you fetch the change log from the client, the change log analyzer analyzing the change log, then so evoke to the minimum the start operation onto the MDT, then determine the which file have to the migrate. So because the change log the information is limited. So we need additional metadata. We need additional metadata information. So that needs the start for the MDT. But we don't want the much of the start operation to the MDT. So we want to use the information from the change log as much as possible. Then finally, this is a framework. So it's a more flexible the backend copy to support it. So right now we are using the DCP in the behind, but you can use any copy tool the behind. So this is a simple architecture on the picture. So you can imagine the two file system, the primary file system, the backup file system, then raster client between them. The raster client is amongst those file system. So you don't need the read-write command on the primary file system. Just a read-only is fine for the guaranteed no data change on the primary file system. Then so the one the data node, the fetch the change log from the MDT. Then change log analyzer analyzing all the change log. Then again so the some additional the start code to MDT to get the additional metadata information with FID. Then after that also we decided which file we need to synchronize. So we split out distribute all other data mover node. The data mover node
the data copy based on the DCP. So this is the complete completed parallel data copied by DCP.
Sorry, could I just ask a question? Show this, the change log itself, you said it retains the minimum amount of information.
Yeah.
So I take it as the I node and some change, bit time set change.
FID and timestamp.
That's why.
Yeah, so there's no the UID or GID stuff.
And is there a maximum size of the change log?
Sorry?
Is there an upper limit to the size of the change log?
No, I don't think so. So it says available to up to MDT. Yeah, but MDT is mostly the metadata. It's a 0-byte file. So it's a lot of the space there. But so the challenge is that if you have a large change log, so it takes a time to fetching the change log. So you probably need the a regular fetching the change log. So finally, this is a synchronization tool, not only the copy tool. So sometimes file have to move, so delete on the backup file system because the primary file system is removed. So we added the --, the delete option. It's a similar idea to the rsync. Then after the data copy, so we remove the unnecessary file from the backup file system to synchronize. Then clear the auto change log. It's a very simple architecture. So this is we had some fundamental the benchmarking during the development phase. So this is one of the benchmark results to compare the change log scanning or rsync file system data detection. So if you look at just one million file from the primary file system and backup file system. So even the rsync is not so bad, 30 seconds. That's not so bad. But if number of the inode increase in the primary file system, so the rsync, the file system detection, it's extremely time consuming. But the change log, it's a little bit going up, but if we look at the, if we think about compared to the rsync, so the 10 million file, it's a 25 times the time reduction compared to the rsync. So this is a really, really significant time reduction for the delta detection in the file system. So this is the experimental performance benchmark number. So we create the 1 million file testing the DC. So 1 million 4K byte, 4K byte, 1 million file, the primary file system, and also the creating on the 1 million file on the backup file system. Then synchronize between the two file system. So again, so 1 million file the scanning the based on change log, it's very quick, just a two seconds. So you cannot see the blue line on the big graph or big graph. So I can just zoom up here. So only a 2 seconds of the scanning from the change log. So we don't care about the delta detection anymore. However, still we have some time Ruby analyzer. So after the collecting the change log, so we need to walk through the change log. So right now still working on that. So we have some cost in here. So that is a red color. So we didn't reduce the timing yet because still the change log analyzer is serialized. So we are now working on the more parallelization, the change log analyzer now. Then green color, this is the copy phase. So the based on the DCP. So if you have the many the data movement on the your machine, your system, so the data copy speed can be there, so can be reduction.
So this is another benchmark number. So one terabyte big single shared file. Because so our sync is based on the file. So when you copy the file, the big file, it's a single thread is just a copy to another file system. But the DCP is more efficient data copy. They can split the chunk of the file, then send to the each of the chunk to the backup file system for the file, in the file of the backup file system. So you can look at, so even the single thread on the DCP, so it's three times faster than other sync. Then even the if we look at the single client performance, so nine times the performance reduction compared to the RSync. Then of course the DCP support the multiple the client with MPI. Then if you can scale the DCP number of the data numbers you have, then finally we got 80% of the bandwidth and the hardware limitation with DCP. So it's quite good. The copy speed is no problem at this point. So next topic, so data migration. So this is a different tool. So the data parallel data migration tool for the Raster. So again, so data migration, they're keeping the metadata, but just change the OSD object, OSD object placement. So we are assuming the data migrating from the SSD to the slow spindle drives, for example. LFS migrate, that command is available today, but that is again no scalability, so limitation. So we are working on the more parallelized data migration tool. This is also based on the DCP. So again, so the LD migrate, so the migrate the OSD object from the one of the OSD place to another OSD placement. Based on the raster data, the layout future. So raster has layout future, which is introduced raster 2.4 maybe. So that is determine which how to address the data to OSD. So if we use the HSM, so the raster layout is running behind, but people not much use the raster layout for other tool. So we are now using the raster layout for LD migrate tool. So we are focusing on the performance and the parallelization, the scalability. This is the user space utility. So if you have a job scheduler, so you can submit the job and the migration, you can submit the migration job. Then, so the integration with the job scheduler is possible. So the more, node allocation by the job scheduler. So this is a simple architecture how the LD migrate works. So normally, if you have a different device on the same raster namespace, typically you need to create a different OSD pool. So you create the OSD pool based on the SSD, then you create another OSD pool based on top of the hard disk. So in this case, so we assuming the so I'm assuming one OSD SSD pool, then one hard disk pool. Then so you need to assign the scratch the tier one directory associated with OSD pool. So the application is running, so writing to the data the SSD pool, if the application writes the scratch the tier directory. Then, so when there's no magic, so we have to copy the data. Then before the copy, so we acquire the group log, because during the copy, so new I/O need to be the resume. Otherwise, make a corrupted. So we are taking a group log, then focusing the data copy between the SSD to OSD. Then after the data copy is finished, then we swap the layout from the temporary file to the new file. Then after the layout changed, so we release the layout of group log, then existing I/O, so new I/O, that can continue to writing to the 5A file or 5A object, but the OSD placement is already changed. So application has transparently access to the file, the same file, but your data is writing to now the spindle drives. So this is a simple the command line. So how do you use that? Just create a two OSD pool, SSD and hard disk OSD pool, then assign to each of the OSD, each pool. Then so allocate the SSD pool, the specific UART directory. Then creating the, so you can create the, any file on that directory, but all of the files will store into the SSD at this point. Then so we can run DCP, the new option dash m, so migrate option. Then so you can specify the new option, the OSD pool, the SSD, so which is where you want to move the data. Then after that, the migration is finished, so all the your data, the placement is changed from the SSD to the disk automatically. But you can still access the same file name. But it just changed to the OSD placement. So that is the conclusion. So I just introduced the two very distinct SSD migrate for the backup and the data migration. Then we are still working on, but the demonstrator right now a huge performance improvement compared to existing the tool or technology. Still working on the performance optimization and the stability, and more, we need more tests for sure. So right now, so this is still under private repository at GitHub, but hopefully, so once we can confirm the stability, so we open the, so we plan to publish the, to those tools as open source, or pushing the path to the file utility or the open source community.